The promise is as real as my present, because all the promise is an announcement about a future that has not yet come to pass. But once God says it, the devil can't stop it, because no weapon against me them in this place. Touch somebody and say, it's going to make me laugh. Touch somebody and say, I'm getting ready to laugh. Woo, I feel it. I feel it. I feel it. Just want to be sad, and God's gonna override your sadness and give you a blessing. You got to chuckle. I'm gonna have some church in here. Somebody just reach back and slap the devil. Get out of here. I feel like having church. I must speak this thing tonight. It is important to understand this, because now the promise becomes the ground by which God reveals his divinity and shows his power over the enemy. If I would point out to you, when he promised he would protect Israel in the middle of bitter water, he showed himself as Jehovah Jireh. Now notice now, he has to allow the circumstance to make it ripe for the revelation. And what God likes is to stack the deck against himself. Oh God, can I come to you and me? Touch your neighbor and say, God's stacking the deck against himself. I ain't got no cards. I ain't got no cards to play. God's the one playing the cards. So he stacks the deck against himself so he can show me it's not me. It's got to be God. God's getting ready to give me a blessing that I couldn't get myself. I might as well have church here by myself. Give somebody a high five and say, that's a ridiculous blessing. There must be promise, because it's promise that makes a person live by faith. If I don't have promise, I can't live by faith. And the just shall live by faith. So promise now makes faith possible, because he promises me, I expect it. Now faith is the hypostasis of things hoped for, the evidence or the helicos of things not seen. I don't see it, but he promised it. I don't see it, but he said it would come to pass. Well, since I know him like I do, I don't have to see it to begin to praise him for it, because if he said it, it's got to come to pass. I'm standing on it. I'm banking on it. I'm praying on it. And when folk laugh at me, I say, you ain't gonna have the last laugh, because I'll be laughing all the way to the bank. I feel a breakthrough. I feel a breakthrough. Oh God, now. What Paul says now is that works can't do it, because God is going to make sure that you understand you didn't work for it. Shake somebody's hand, say, you didn't work for it. You ain't that good. You ain't that powerful. Because now, if I could work for it, then it would be wages. And if I can earn it, it can't be that much, because I ain't got that kind of earning power. So I want it to be by faith, So it is by promise. You see, it's got to be by faith for it to be by promise. If it's by law, then it's by works. And I don't want to work for it. I want a blessing that I can't work for. I want a house that I can't work for. I want a woman that when I look at her, I say, glory be to God. I feel the Holy Ghost. And, well, excuse me, that was personal. The challenge, you can't work it out. Oh God, the channel is that of faith. And now then, how do I receive it? If I don't work for it, I've got to have a source to get it. And the source is faith. Because faith bridges to God, and everything he gives me comes through faith. So what God does by faith is he simply asks me to stretch out my hand and receive what he wants to give. If I were to bring you $1,000 and I were to put it in your hand and you stretch out your hand to get it, you didn't work for it. You just received it. Touch three people and say, receive it. That's all you got to do is receive it. Receive it. Receive it. He promised it. Receive it. He said he would. Receive it. He turned back heaven. Receive it. He opened up the way. Receive it. That's all you have to do is receive what God has told you he's going to give you. I feel it here. So now he says, let me get somebody as an example so the children of the church will understand how I work. He calls a man at 75 years old and he disrupts his life. Touch your neighbor, say the first thing is the vision will disrupt your life. God will tell you, step out on faith. Oh God, I feel it now. Step out on faith. You've been going by your intellect too long. You've been going by your plans too long. You've been trying to set up some stuff too long. The Lord says, step out. Now, the Lord is the only person I know that'll take a man on a job and have him give up the job to start a church. Can I preach like I feel it? You see that man right there. This was a vision, but he had a job. Now, the question is, do you believe God enough to give up this for what you got in your head? Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. Oh, I got to preach this. Do you have enough nerve for the Lord to upset your house and you get up and tell everybody, I'm on the way out? Where you going? I don't know where I'm going, but I'm going. I just heard go. Lord, I feel it in here. I preach like I feel it. Give somebody a high five and tell them, just go, honey. If God tell you go, just go. Well, ain't nobody going with me. Forget them, forget them, forget them. Just go. Just go, just go. The man now moves out. And I tell you, you can be in the will of God and not know where you're going. And I understand why God plays like that. Because if I tell you how to get from here to a spot in Fort Worth, and I give you the directions. Now, most of us, if we're going to travel in a caravan, we want to know the directions just in case I lose you. But now, if I don't know the directions, I can't afford to lose you. So that's the reason God does not show me the whole direction, but he gives me little at a time. So he won't lose me, and I'll keep saying, where did God go? Where did God go? Where did God go? Where did God go? I got to follow God. He knows where the place. because now the man is out there. Now the second thing is, he does not move as quick as you feel he should, because now he is testing your faith. Oh, I feel it now. Touch your neighbor, say, I hate to wait. Oh, yeah. Touch somebody else behind you, say, I really hate to wait. I want it right now. But if I get it right now, then I would not develop character, because my character says I need to be strong enough to wait on God in spite of how long it takes. Because what God promised me takes a little time to prepare, because he ain't giving me just anything. He's giving me the best of everything, and he ain't rushing to put it together. Oh, I got to preach in here tonight. Oh, not only that, sometimes the gift is too good for the person receiving it. Can I talk to you a minute? You want the best man in town, but are you yet the best woman in town? It don't make sense for God to give his best to somebody who ain't ready yet. So while you're waiting on the gift, he's raising your value. I got to preach in here. God's gonna make you laugh. God's gonna make you laugh. I feel the Holy Spirit. So God just held up until Abraham got through his mess. He kept on denying Sarah, kept on acting like she was his sister and not his wife. And God had to bring him through that for him to understand, if I promise you a child, the devil can't kill you. Sarah understood that she was not in the hand of Abraham, because when he sent her into Abimelech's bed, she just crawled right up in it and just waited for God to deliver in the night and said, don't you touch her, because she is my anointed child. Can I preach to you? Had to get through Hagar, get through trying to help God. Touch three people, say, quit trying to help him. He knows what you need. He knows who you need. And he knows when you need it. You've messed up picking yourself. How many times you've chosen a mess? Quit choosing and sit down and let somebody choose you. God knows how to work it out. Now, he promised a man at 75, and you know that's pretty tough, but it must have been possible, because at 86, he had a child with Hagar, which means the record shows he wasn't quite dead enough. Look at your neighbor, say, your situation ain't quite dead enough. The devil ain't whooped you quite enough. God is waiting until the jury is out, until the devil comes back with all of his imps and say, it ain't gonna happen. Just like I told you, God waited too long. The man is now 100 and the woman is 90. Tell somebody Abraham was dead. Tell somebody Sarah was dead. Tell them now they double dead. Now here's where God is getting ready to work, because now things have become ridiculous. Touch your neighbor, say, that's ridiculous. Can't an old man that old have no baby with an old woman that old? That's ridiculous. So when Sarah heard it, she began to laugh and said, somebody must be crazy, but this ain't gonna happen. But I heard the Lord say, is there anything too hard for God? Do I have a child of God in here that has the nerve to tell your situation? situation, there ain't nothing too hard for God. This job is not too hard for God. This house is not too hard for God. This relationship is not too hard for God. This raise is not too hard for God. I want something ridiculous. Can I preach? I'm getting ready to close. But I feel the power of the Lord. Shake somebody's hand and say, neighbor, it takes a ridiculous blessing to make you laugh. A baby at 90, fathered at 100, just enough to make you laugh. Preach this thing. What? How big is your house? God's gonna give you a house so big when the neighbors walk by, they say, how many people live in this house? And you tell them two, they say, that's ridiculous. You have, and you tell them I got five, and they say, are you by yourself? You say yes, and they say, that's ridiculous. I feel the Holy Ghost touch three people. So that's the kind of blessing I got to have, a ridiculous blessing. How much money you got in the bank? Who blessed you so quick? Last year you were nothing, this year you're on the mountaintop. Last year you were hurt, this year you got victory. Who did it for you? God did it. That's ridiculous. When you tell them where he's taking you, tell them how high you're going, they look at you like you're crazy and say, that's ridiculous. And you tell them, yeah, that makes me laugh. Somebody touch your neighbor, throw your head back, and go to high.
The Lord said, you are going to receive such a ridiculous blessing that you don't have to just sit back and laugh. Sarah said, the Lord hath made me laugh. As you bow your heads around this altar down through the aisles, somebody here knows how things have slipped out of your control. And what happens now is what was difficult has now become literally impossible. And this is where God makes you laugh. Because he is stepping in right now to bring a revelation of himself to you, because you already have the promise. Don't let the promise slip, because the promise is your future. And I'm excited about your future, because you're going to give birth to laughter.